Hello, and thanks so much for joining us. I'm Carol Jenkins. The program is Black America. And after almost 2 years on Zoom, we are back in the CUNY TV studio and joined by Vanessa De Luca, editor-in-chief at The Root, a digital magazine that provides commentary and news from a variety of Black perspectives. Vanessa is an award-winning journalist who has been a driving force for many companies such as Glamour and Life, Zora Magazine by Medium, and notably her work at Essence Magazine from 2013 to 2018. And during that time, we were fortunate to have her as a guest here on Black America for the first time, and we are delighted to have you back. Vanessa, thank you for being here on our premiere Back in the Studio show.
Oh, thank you so much for having me. It's wonderful to be here in person.
In person. And I wanted to talk with you. The work at The Root, you know, so interesting. You've just released the 100, you know, top Black Americans from 25 to 45. Which is that pivotal time period where great things have already happened and much more can happen. Talk to us about that. I was especially struck by your wording around the time that this list was being created, which is different perhaps from other times.
Yes, I mean, you know, I think that the importance of the list has never been more amplified than this year, especially when we're talking about how you think about how our contributions to history are being erased literally from the history books, with, you know, that people are challenging the right to teach critical race theory in schools. What better time for us to come out with the Root 100, where we're acknowledging our contributions and our efforts and our status in the country.
Yeah. So a lot of that is being taken away, so it seems, you know, and actually put into practice in schoolrooms across this country, where, you know, books about Rosa Parks or kindergartners are being removed from the classroom. All of that, you know, it's just an extraordinary backlash. But I say to you, weren't we just in the Black Lives Matter, George Floyd moment where millions of people were marching in the streets and diversity programs were being created?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, there was a moment, a period of time in 2020 where it seemed that Black America was finally getting recognition, finally getting acknowledgement for everything that we've done and everything that we've contributed. That moment caused a backlash, I believe. When you think about what happened on January 6th, you think about the insurrection, you think about how people have reacted and responded to all of those efforts to bring more truth and truthfulness to what is our collective history. And it's mind-boggling to me how we've been able to kind of flip the switch so quickly.
I know, it's like most of us still don't realize how seriously that switch has been flipped and the serious work that needs to be done to hold ground and build ground.
Absolutely. And that's why I think that things like the Root 100 are really important, because it allows us to acknowledge not just people who are, you know, the big names, the famous people that you would expect to be on the list, like a Beyonce or like a Zendaya, but to acknowledge those people who have made contributions that are life-changing for us in so many ways, that show that our activism and, you know, our purpose really does have an incredible influence on the world.
And I said to you, I'm a little worried because I didn't recognize many of the names, you know, and the big ones I did. And you said that was on purpose, you know.
Oh, that's very intentional. We want to make sure that people who don't always get that shine are actually acknowledged. For example, our number one pick this year was Kizmekia Corbett, who played an instrumental role in developing the Moderna vaccine. How could we not, in a year that was so focused on COVID-19, acknowledge someone who brought so much to the table and obviously probably had to sacrifice many long nights and days to come up with something that has impacted on millions of lives. How incredible is that?
I know, and she really hasn't yet gotten the credit that she deserved for that.
No.
Really, it seemed as if she had to fight to say, oh, you know, I'm here and, you know, you can count on me for having saved your life. You know,
well, fortunately, the people at Harvard recognized that, you know, that she, you know, had a lot to contribute, and so she has a space there.
Right, right. I was glad that they created that. Of course, Nicole Hannah-Jones, who is in the thick of the critical race theory, 1619, you know, fight that we have to wage.
Yes, she's been on the list for, I think this is her third time on the list. And what better year to recognize just everything that she went through in terms of her struggle to get tenure, her ultimate decision to own what she felt to be true and to turn away from that offer and to go to Howard University and establish and her own kind of chair and authority in that space, I think is remarkable. And it demonstrates to, I think, so many young people that you don't always have to go the path that is actually kind of prescribed for you, that you do have an opportunity to make your own, to create your own fate and to go your own way.
So I'm fascinated by the algorithm, speaking of, you know, the future, you know, all of the, and we're always yelling at Facebook for its algorithms, but, you know, the way you found these people and gauged them in terms of their contribution to, you know, to this country was so interesting. Talk to us a little bit about it. It's like a mega, you know, combination of many, many things. It's how we get you on this list of only the top 100.
Absolutely. And so there's reach is like the first thing that we think about. We look at people's social media presence, how many followers they have, what kind of talk there is about them on the social media landscape, how many media appearances and mentions they've gotten in the media. So there's the reach. Then we look at the substance of what they've contributed that particular year. What was that one thing or many things that they brought to the table over the past year that we should be recognizing? And so that those two things combined equal their influence. And then we rank their influence based on those two factors. We assign numbers to them. We have an outside firm that does kind of like the calculations of the algorithm for us, and they come up with this list. Now, that's not to say that we still don't have our own kind of opinions. You know, the team definitely has a lot to say about, well, I don't know if that person really should be number 15 or number 20.
You know, that's the hard part. Definitely included in the list, but are they number 12 or number 15?
That is the absolute hardest part, and we spend hours and hours debating about that. But I think ultimately the list is a very fair list. We come up with, the algorithm allows us to really give people an opportunity that may not necessarily otherwise be recognized.
I know you're creating pathways for so many of the people, you know, on the list. So that is fantastic. So as amazing as it seems, this is the 12th year of the Root 100 list.
Yes, it's been an incredible ride. Just being able to acknowledge all of these extraordinary men and women from ages 25 to 45. And all the accomplishments that they've had over the past year. Ever since Professor Henry Louis Gates started the Root, partnered with the Washington Post.
Right, and so I remember those early days so well. You know, but now for 12 years you've been calculating. Let's get our numbers organized.
Yes, for 12 years, and you know, and we, you know, we're going to keep going. We think it's a very important list.
Right. So now, in addition to that, you've got the Root Institute. So talk to us a little bit about that. I mean, of the many things that you provide on your web, the root.com, by the way, you know, for getting the full list of the 100 and for many of the other things that are offered. So the Institute also goes deep into discussions of things that are important to us.
Yes. Speaking of critical race theory, we had the Root Institute is our opportunity to have in-depth conversations about just so many things that are going on in our community, whether you're talking about COVID-19, critical race theory, you know, LGBTQ issues. It runs the gamut. And so this year, the Root Institute was a virtual experience. You can go on the root.com and view many of the conversations that we had. And they ranged from things like talking about storytelling and how we approach storytelling, to things like, why do people feel so threatened by critical race theory?
Right, right. Yes, a very, and by the way, critical race theory is not being taught in elementary school or high school, or even college for that matter, perhaps, but it's a law school legal theory, but you know, great shorthand and very well used in terms of storytelling.
Yes.
And messaging by, you know, the people who don't care so much for the inclusion of us in, you know,
yes,
in history. So,
but we had some, I mean, we had some really incredible guests this year with the Root Institute. So Tarana Burke, obviously, with her new book.
Right.
She talks very much about Unbound and kind of her inspiration for the book.
Right.
And for the movement. We had Brittany Cooper.
Love Brittany Cooper.
Tressie McMillan Cottom.
Right.
Yara Shahidi. The list goes on. And these are all people who, in our community, are valued for the stake that they take, mm-hmm, and the investment that they make, mm-hmm, in our community, mm-hmm, and they're not shy about it. And that's what we like about the Root Institute. Really is in existence to inform and inspire, and to make us feel like we can take action on our own.
Right. So, and all of this is happening in the digital space. And I was,
yes,
asking you a little bit before we began recording about the future. Do we still have paper magazines, even books for that matter, in our future? Or is the digital space the future? And is that where we're going to get our information?
I mean, I do think that digital is the way forward for so many of us. But there's always going to be a special place, I think, for certain publications.
I know, piling up in my living room, right? That's the,
yes,
place for them. I'm one of those. I better keep this because there may not be another. What we,
that's
used,
right,
to call hard
New
copies.
York Ma- I mean, New York. Ma- I mean, I still subscribe to some magazines. You know, there are certain magazines that are kind of, you know, legendary and have a special place in our homes. I mean, Essence is one of them. I like to think of, you know, Ebony. You think of New York Magazine, The New Yorker. There are so many that still have that authority in the print space, and I think that they'll continue to exist. Maybe there won't be as many competitors. That's the piece.
Because already the space is getting pretty small, where some of the big
Absolutely.
Guns, so to speak, you know, are throwing in the towel and saying we're done. We can't.
Absolutely. I never imagined that Time Inc. would be one of the companies that no longer exists. And now we're talking about Meredith merging with IAC, you know, Barry Diller's company. Some of these mergers and collapsing of, right, businesses, just, it wasn't even thought possible even 10 years ago.
I know. In the space of, I guess it's really the last 5 or 3 years, even, that,
absolutely,
you know, suddenly we see the collapse. I know that you've got a sense of this idea of where are the Black journalists, the writers, the storytellers. You know, how are we faring in all of this collapse and change to digital, change to streaming? I know that The Root covers, you know, the films, Broadway, politics, everything. You know, but where, how are we faring? In the newsrooms, for instance,
I think that there's still opportunities in newsrooms for there to be more diversity. And I think that some newsrooms have recognized that and acknowledged that, and others maybe not so much. Certainly in our newsroom, you know, diversity is at a premium. That's something that we really care about because we want to give young Black journalists an opportunity to learn, to grow, to, you know, hone their craft, to make sure that they understand what it really means to tell a compelling story. Those are things that we're going to need regardless. Mm-hmm. I mean, that will never go out of style. The mechanism that we use to tell those stories digitally, through video, through Insta stories, through TikTok, all these different various ways we have of telling stories now, that will change. But the idea of how to tell a story well, I think, will never change. And that's what I think is important for us who are in the medium right now, to teach the young people how to do that. What constitutes a great story? That still means a lot, and it goes a long way.
Yeah, and the value of our stories, you know, because for so many years that was
absolutely
the problem.
Sidelined, and still in many ways, you know, the mainstream still does not get our stories really, the nuances, you know, the texture, the richness of what we bring to the table. That is not always showcased in the stories that the mainstream tells. You know, it's very conventional. It's very predictable and sometimes very stereotypical.
Right. I noticed that Cori Bush, Congresswoman Bush, is on your list of 100, and she strikes me as being, you know, having gone to Washington and taken it by storm and talking about not, you know, honoring the old-fashioned route of this is important and this is not. You know, she's like, no, I'm doing it, and I'm doing it now. And, you know, AOC and the squad did it before, so sort of, I think, set the stage for it. But she brings, I don't know, a realness, you know, to her commitment. Talk to us a little bit about politics and, you know, Black America. I mean, the fact that she slept out on the steps.
That's right.
You know, and managed to make change. So that is an example in terms of politics or the political world.
I think that the young people coming into, and there are many politicians on our list, people who are new to, you know, to politics, made the Root 100 list this year. I think that the new people are bringing in this fresh energy and this, who says that we have to do things the old way?
Right.
It's because it's always been done that way. Who says that we do? Really an attitude of let's break some rules. Let's, you know, let's shake up the apple cart a little bit and think about how we can make differences on our own terms. I think that that's fascinating and brilliant and bold and quite courageous, actually, that, you know, that people want to bring that type of energy to the table, and it's probably about time for that too.
Right. I'm thinking about Kamala Harris, our vice president, and the space that she seems to be in now as we're recording this, where there are a lot of blowback, a lot of, you know, her ratings are low, you know, she's not being treated well by the president. I mean, these are some of the stories that are circulating. But again, for Black women, the fact that she is there now and the way she's being treated, you know, how do you assess that? Because it's like the highest we've had, you know, for people to view the way Black women can be treated.
Well, it's that old thing of how Black women are treated in the workplace. I mean, just the fact that she is our vice president doesn't make it any different when you think about how Black women are perceived in the workplace. Often we're perceived as a threat. Often we're perceived as the angry Black woman. Often we are told that, you know, we're not trying to fit in, or, you know, that we're, you know, that we are, that we don't, we're not team players.
Right.
Let's put it that way. And
because a lot of people accuse her of wanting to run, and therefore she's, yeah.
That's so. Right. And so I think she's getting the same treatment. I think that people are looking at her and saying, oh, let's put some of these old tropes that we've used against Black women for years in the workplace and apply them to her. But I think that that's incredibly unfair. It's incredibly discouraging that, you know, that we finally have someone in this, you know, this once in a lifetime position, and we can't even afford her the grace to give her the time to actually do the work that she's set out to do.
Yeah.
And I honestly think that there's, you know, it's a part, it goes back to this whole thing about the backlash, right?
Right.
That we talked about earlier. I mean, I feel like this is a part of that.
That it is. But the president's ratings are failing as well. Especially, he's losing Black support, again, at the time that we're recording this, based on unfulfilled promises that many Black voters went to the polls and voted for this ticket. And here, as we stand, the most devastating problem for us is the fact that voting is being suppressed in every single way by the new laws being enacted, by gerrymandering, you know, the Supreme Court's, you know, decisions. So I don't know, you know, how much blame or responsibility do we give to this new administration, because
Well, a lot of this was in the works before the current administration came into power. I mean, let's be clear. A lot of the voter suppression acts and changes in the voting rights laws were happening under Trump, and so to turn back rewind that back and pull back all these things that have already been in process and progress well before Biden came into office is a difficult thing. It's not that easy to do. That's why people were sounding the alarm back when it was happening during the Trump administration. Unfortunately, not enough people were listening.
Right, and are they listening now? My sense is that we still seem to be under some sort of sedative that we think that, first of all, what, do we have no power to change this, or what's...
I think, quite honestly, people are exhausted. I mean, we were talking earlier about the pandemic and just how over this past almost 2 years, people have been dealing with a lot of change, a lot of upheaval in their lives, a lot of making adjustments that no one expected us to make, a lot of emotional, mental, physical challenges, right? And so we've become so focused on those things that we're not necessarily thinking about what's happening outside of our everyday lives and I think that there's a lot of people who are counting on that and that are looking at that and saying, okay, well, now is the time when we can push through a lot of these things that aren't necessarily to Black people's advantage or to people of color's advantage.
I don't know. It's a frightening time in so many ways, and we know that we are on the cusp of 2022, where big elections are taking place, reproductive rights being challenged in a very, very serious way.
Supreme Court is looking at making a landmark decision about an abortion case. There's a lot on the table right now for so many of us. And my hope is that the people that we have brought to the table, like the Cori Bushes of the world, like the Kamala Harrises of the world, will be able to jump in and represent us in ways that we can't necessarily do on our own.
Well, I know the Root will be there absolutely presenting because you cover it all. I mean, and again, I recommended Vanessa De Luca is one of the best editors ever.
As, thank you.
You know, that whole, the Essence Festivals, the major work that was done to create a space for, you know, for Black women. And now you're doing it at the Root. So we thank you so much for that and expect to be reading the Root to get the answers to how we make it through 2022.
That's right. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Oh, it is my pleasure. You know, I just knew that we wanted to talk with you again because you always have your finger on the pulse of this country and especially the way it affects Black America. So thank you so much.
Thank you.
So our thanks so much to Vanessa De Luca, editor-in-chief of The Root. You can also visit The Root at root.com, theroot.com, and catch all that they're covering in entertainment, in politics, in culture, and more. Thanks to you out there for joining us as well. I'm Carol Jenkins. The program is Black America, and we'll see you the next time.